Good morning, everyone. I propose we start with this webinar presented by Expat Housing Network, and it's titled Buying a Home in Groningen. Today, we will record the meeting, so we will share with you afterwards as well, so you don't have to take too many notes. And I'm presenting the webinar, but also my colleague, Katie, is joining us in the chat. So whenever you have some questions, you can put them in the chat, and we will come back to that later, at the end of the session or in between when it's the right moment to answer your specific questions. Let's start and go forward. My name is Philip. I'm the business unit manager with Expat Housing Network, and I'm from Belgium. I'm the proud father of a daughter of 3 years old, but she believes in the meantime that she's 10 years old. So sometimes that gives a lot of funny moments. I bought a home in the Netherlands myself 3 years ago, so I know how to do it and what are the do's and don'ts. So we will come back to that later. Of course, it's interesting to see what we are going to talk about today. We start with a little introduction, going through the mind state of buying a house. What do you need of savings in the market on today? And 3 tips to win in the market. And then we end with the process and the timeline. How long does it take to buy a home? And what are the steps that you need to take step by step? First of all, greatness is achieved in the agency of others. That means that I'm not doing the job on my own. We have a big team, Katie, Giovanna, Ludo, Raffaella, Alana, and Rick. They're all at your disposal to search for a home, to negotiate about a home, and to be able to buy a nice place that you can call your home afterwards. So all of them have experience with living abroad, speaking different languages, and also searching for a place themselves in the Netherlands. So they know what they are talking about. We are not the traditional real estate agent as EHN. We are a real estate agent. We know what we do, but we try to do the things a little bit different with the focus on customer services. And also with the focus on transparency. Every time we explain something to you, we don't always give you a number. We give you a number, but also the reason why. We help you with buying, also with renting, but I'm sure that you were following this webinar because you want to buy something. We don't sell houses, so that's the difference. We're always at the side of the buyer. That's our focus, that's how we work. And so, we always support you to close the best deal. We charge a fixed fee, so we don't charge any commission. If you buy a house of 500,000 or 700,000 or 300,000, or it doesn't matter what is the price, we always charge you a fixed fee with the same services that we offer. And we know what it is like to settle in a new country, as I just told you. So we also understand that there are specific questions when you're not born in the Netherlands or didn't live here for a long time and you come back, what are the pitfalls or what are some specific topics to look at when you like to settle in a new country. Selling agents take our offers more seriously. That is important because you will ask, okay, maybe I can do everything myself. Why do I need a buying agent? We see a lot of times that when an offer is made by yourself or when we help you with that, that when we make the offer, that the selling agents also know that we did our homework, as we say that, and that we looked into every detail to make sure that when we make an offer, we will also sign the purchase agreement and go forward until the end of the process to buy the house. And that gives some comfort to the selling agents as well, and some comfort to the sellers, of course, which can be a difference when they need to value the offer that you made. We can also sometimes book viewings when that is no longer possible for you. That is because some parties have some time slots for selling agents or buying agents that come by, and then we can help you with speaking to our relations. We support by reviewing the Dutch legal and property documents, also very important because you want to like to buy a house, but not have the hassle that at a certain moment you discover things that you didn't know before. So therefore, we are there to support you and to do the review of all documents that most of the time are always in Dutch and that are very interesting to look at before you make the offer, both on the legal side, the technical side, and also the financial side of the property. We help, of course, to define the market value through market data. We don't do that automated. There is somebody in our office doing this on a daily basis. He looks at different properties and really is going to look into detail. Okay, if we have this property in the street and we compare it to other properties that are similar and sold lately, what is then to be the value of the property that also after the appraiser came on site will put in the report that is the basis for your mortgage. We will inform you about the rules and regulations, very important as well. And we also want to avoid you that sometimes we also made mistakes or we saw clients making a little mistake. We want to avoid that. So we are there for you to instruct you and to make sure that the process goes smoothly. Maybe interesting for us to know, you can drop it in the chat where you are in the process on today. Are you still in the orientation phase? Are you searching already? Are you doing some viewings or did you submit an offer in the meantime? Please let us know and then we will share it with you. I see some people are still in the orientation phase, so that's totally at the beginning. That's very good because that means that it's very ideal to follow then this webinar first to know exactly what steps are the next ones. So perfect that you follow our webinar today. And then we're going to talk about the mind state. The mind state of going into the market. How does the market look like? I'm sorry, something is going wrong here on a technical level. Yeah, this is better. And what is important for you to know for the different numbers that apply. Maybe first to see that, and these are the numbers that apply on the Netherlands. The average house price last quarter went to 419,000 euros. That's a big amount, and that's only the average house price. So there are houses that are more expensive as well. We see that if you compare that year to year, that the prices went up with 19%. So we can speak of a very bullish market, that is clear. You see as well that the houses that are for sale went down with 43%. So that's very clear that the offer in the market is not that great at the moment, which of course is one of the main reasons that the prices go up as well, because a lot of people that are looking for a place but cannot find something, it means that the prices will go up. That's economical law, and that applies on the market on today. And then we see that the houses that are for sale, they are for sale for only 23 days. It's a very important step that you take. If you buy a house, you will spend a lot of money and then you only have 23 days to close that deal. So you see as well that that is very important to be aligned with all the conditions that apply and to know before you start the process exactly what is your budget and what are your pitfalls or what are your main elements to look at in detail. Average house price in Groningen, 321,000 euros. You see that even in Groningen, the prices went up higher than they did in average in the Netherlands. They went up with 25%. So that's a big jump in 1 year time. The houses for sale in Groningen went down with 33%. Also there, more than 30% lower offer in the market. And you see that the houses were only for sale like 21 days in specific in Groningen. So you need to be fast, that is clear. If you see then the development over the last years, you see clearly that we had a little dip starting from 2012 going to 2013-14. But then it picked up again in 2015, and then it went up since then. And for sure, if we would go further in this graph and draw the line for 2021, then it only goes up, and I think it goes even faster than it did before. What is the main elements that are driving the prices and the market on today? You will see that over here, the first one is the fiscal benefits. We have the tax exemption that applies. That means that people that are under 35 and only buy a house until 400,000 euros, that they can be exempted from tax. That means that they don't have to pay any transfer tax. If you are a mixed couple, like one person is below 35 and the other is not, then only one person will have to pay on his share in the purchase, the transfer tax, and the other can be exempted. And there are also exemptions for still for parents that offer 100,000 euros to their children that invest that in real estate. They can be exempted for that as well as giving it as a gift without taxes. The second thing that applies is the interest rebate. You are still allowed to deduct the interest from your income on a yearly basis before you get taxed. So also there, it's interesting to have a mortgage and to deduct the interest. And there are no capital gains. So whenever you sell your house, you can use that extra value of the house to invest in something else, and you don't need to pay any taxes on the capital gains you had with buying the house and selling it later. Very nice fiscal benefits. On top of that, we have low interest rates. It's like historical low interest rates that apply on today. What we see is that now slightly some banks start raising the interest rates slowly, but it has not a major impact on today on the cost of your mortgage. And we also have to say that, as I said, it's historical low interest rates that apply. So still it's very interesting to get a mortgage. Alternative to buying is renting a place, but the rents are quite high on today. So if you take the decision, or I'm going just to rent and then give the money to say to the landlord, that's what you're doing, you're not building up equity, or you can buy something, have a mortgage and build up your equity as well, of course, because you pay a little bit of equity and the rest is interest rate, but the most of it is value that you add to your own portfolio, to say, then we see that the rents are high, and that even on today, sometimes it's more beneficial in your monthly installments to have a mortgage and to pay your monthly installment over there than really to pay rent that can be higher in today's market. And then, of course, what still applies is, I started already with that, the lack of supply. It has a big influence on the market in the sense that a lot of people are searching. I believe we need every year like around 100,000 houses that need to be built. But on today, that is not happening. And of course, also going forward, there will be new joiners in the country as well. And we even need to build extra houses for that. We hope all for a government that hopefully will start soon and that will take some actions for that. And they already promised to put 1 billion into the market over 10 years. But some parties believe that we need 1 billion every year to go forward. It is good that we see some new builds are coming into the market. So that's a good start in different cities. But we still need more to have like a balance between the demand and the supply in the market on today. So all these elements give as a result that we still believe that the next coming time period, months, even a year or 2 years, the prices will still go up. It is possible if the new government will change some rules that the market will slow down a little bit. And for sure, if they do something about capital gains of interest rebates, it can also be that if the interest rates go up, that the market slows down a little bit. But still, all experts on today believe that the prices will go up the next month and the next year as well, for sure. Of course, we don't have a glass ball, so it's something that we deduct from the information we have on today, but it seems to be very likely. And then for yourself, you will say, okay, I have to finance that purchase. How many savings do I need before I start? That's very important, of course, the budget to start when you buy a house. Therefore, I made a little bit of a summary of all the costs that are implied with making the purchase. The first and most important one is the transfer tax. You see that that's 2% of the purchase price. So it's not on the value or the asking price, but 2% on the purchase price that you will pay. And you can be exempted, as I said before, if you're younger than 35 and if you buy up to 400K, and you benefit from that for the first time. If you don't have that exemption, then you pay the 2%. If you're going to live in there yourself, always take into account, if you do it as an investment, then you will pay 8% of transfer tax. For the rest, what are the other costs that apply? You see that the notary for the mortgage deed, for the transfer deed, you will also maybe need a mortgage broker, or your bank itself will also charge you a little fee for doing their work. Then you have a real estate agent. You can choose a typical one who charges percentage, or we charge you only a fixed amount, as I said before. You have the appraiser and the technical inspector. We will talk about them later as well. And then you have the interpreter when you sign the transfer deed with the notary. Then you always need an interpreter over there. For the deposit that you pay, it's 10% on the purchase price. You can do that with your own savings, and then it's the 10% you paid as a deposit to the notary, or you can also choose to use a bank guarantee. You will pay a little amount on that, around 250 euros, normally it will be, and that will be to bridge the period between signing the purchase contract, where you have the condition to pay a deposit, and then the moment that you sign the transfer deed and everything is paid with the mortgage and some of your own savings. And then you also have the NHG, the National Mortgage Guarantee, that applies. It can give you some interesting interest rates, and also, yeah, a guarantee when you're not able to pay your mortgage anymore. But here is a cap that applies of 325,000 euros on today and 355,000 euros next year. So you always need to see if you fit the conditions to apply for that. That's the savings that you need. Of course, that's the saving that you need for the closing fees. And it can be that, and that we're going to see a little bit later, that you need a little bit of savings as well to make your offer and to make the winning offer. But we come to that in a moment. I will give you now three tips to win in the current market. As I said, it's a competitive market, it's a bullish market. So you need to be prepared, budget, we just spoke about, very important. And then you have some rules of thumb maybe to say, and some tips that can make you, make the winning offer in the market. And the first one is maybe the most important. It's called value, value, value. What is important about that, you will see on the next slide, we have a house that is for sale at an asking price of 395,000 euros. And then we see that over here, the market value, that's something we will define together with you. We say based on all the sales that we see in the neighborhood, the market value is 415,000 euros. And finally, the house gets sold, or you buy it for 435,000 euros. What is the difference with the asking price over here? That is very clear. It's 40K, the difference between the 435,000 as the final purchase price and the asking price in the beginning, 395,000 is 40K, and that's 10% difference that we see. The difference with the market value, the difference between the 435,000 and the 415,000 is 20K, that's almost 5% difference. Yeah. This is the first example where we have an asking price of 395,000, market value of 415,000, and purchase price of 435,000 euros. And then we go to the same house, but a different situation. Here, the asking price is 375,000 euros, so a little bit lower. The market value, it stays the same, of course. We did our homework and we saw the value of the house is 415,000. There is no change in that. And the purchase price is 435,000. Euros. That's all the same. What we see over here is that the difference between the asking price and the purchase price here is 60K, so 16,000, 16% And so it's a bigger difference between the asking price and the purchase price than in the first example. Although the difference between the purchase price and the market value is still that 20K and still 5%. Yeah. Why do I say that? It's important to see that a lot of people are always putting the question forward, how much do I need to overbid on the asking price? And then we say, stop, that's the wrong question. You always need to ask, how much do I want or do I need to overbid on the market value? Yeah, the market value is important. It will be the 100% where the bank gives you the mortgage and you can finance with the mortgage. And then maybe because the market is bullish on the property that you're looking at, you will need to overbid a little bit with your own savings. Yeah. So that's the exercise we do every time. We look at the value, value, value. And then based on that, we're going to draft the offer together with you. Of course, it's interesting to see in general what the market is doing on asking prices, but for sure, it's not the most important to make the winning bid. The second thing is to make a winning offer. Also important, of course. What are we going to see over there is the first thing is you need to offer a good price. Yeah, a good price is not always the highest price, but it's a price, as I just explained, that is in line with the value of the property. Of course, that has a certain relation to, in general, what the market is doing in that region. The second thing is to offer security to your seller. What does that mean is that when the seller knows that, for example, you have some own savings already, you're going to use that, and that you say, I will not need a mortgage for 100%, but I need it for 90%, and that person I can give you as well, that will give him some comfort. You can maybe as well already ask your mortgage advisor to draft a little email. We can add that to the offer as well. I mean, or all those different conditions that will add to the security to the seller that you will start the process and it will also end in signing the transfer deed and go forward. Or of course, also to offer the least amount of hassle. It's always a little bit a stressful period to buy something or to sell something. Also from the for the seller, if he has no hassle, then that's the offer he's going to choose. And that can depend on some movables maybe that you take over. He says, okay, I have some furniture, but it would be more comfortable if I just leave it and you take it over for a small amount or even for free. Or at a certain moment, he wants to move and he says, yeah, I prefer to have the transfer date. Maybe if you are speaking today, after the holidays, I want to do it beginning of January. Is that possible for you as well? You say, of course, for me, it's not that important and it gives a lot less hassle for you as well. So all those elements will make that they will decide for your offer or another one. And the last one, also important, is to add a personal touch. For sure, a seller lived in that house as well. It's his place. Often it's more emotional than you would think. And if you give a little personal touch with explaining who you are and why you're looking in that neighborhood or why you like the house that much, then it will always help to make an offer that has more chance to win than that of the competition. And then the last one, the third tip that we can offer you is to do a very good due diligence. You want to buy a house. You want to give a good price to be sure that you have it. You want to make all conditions of the offer in line with what is expected by the seller. But you want, in the end as well, to buy a house where afterwards you say, I did a good deal and I'm very happy with it. And then you don't want to have like a lot of technical things or also something maybe with the value that is not totally in line with your expectations. And that's why we speak with the technical inspector and the appraiser. These two experts will come into the story the moment that you made your offer. Yeah. Good thing is to know, do we just before we make the offer or do we do it just after we make the offer? Maybe you can add something in the chat if you think that you know. After making the offer, I see here in the chat somebody else that has an idea. And I see also some that thing before. I will reply to you with the answer. We book them after making the offer. Why do we do that? We could book them before making the offer, but it means that every time that you're going to a viewing, they come in, they will do their report and they will charge you a fee. Yeah. On today, it's not likely that every time when you do a viewing and you make an offer that you are sure that you win the offer. So you will pay a lot of money in doing that. And that's why we say, okay, it's not at the moment that before we make the offer, but it's just afterwards, the sweet spot, as we call it. And it's most likely to be within 1 week after acceptance of the offer. Yeah. What we did before making the offer, that's our job. That's looking to all property documents to be sure that also on a technical level, we can believe that everything is okay. And two is that we make a valuation somewhere of the price range where we expect for the appraiser to put the value. Yeah, that's our job. And with that information, you can make a good offer. Yeah. But then before signing the purchase contract, as you can see on the screen, after the offer is accepted, you will go to sign the purchase contract. We want to be absolutely sure that there is no risk involved anymore. And then the technical expert and the appraiser come on site. The technical inspector will give you a report where they will state, okay, we looked at the property. This is the state on today. This is the maintenance to be expected within 1 year. This is the maintenance to be inspected within 5 years. And if there is really a major element that is technically not okay, then they will inform you as well, of course, to take that into account. The appraiser comes on site as well, sometimes together with the technical inspector. He will just look around and then make his homework in his office again. But he always needs to visit the premises once to calculate the correct value of your property. And of course, that you will need because that is necessary to make the application of your mortgage. They will ask the signed purchase contract together with the report of the appraiser to apply for your mortgage. So you see that we most of the time will have the reports of the technical appraiser and appraiser for the valuation at the moment of signing the purchase contract. We always have it within the 3 days that follow on signing of the purchase contract. And that is important for you because you see after signing of the purchase contract, there is still a cooling off period. And the moment that you have all that information before, you are sure that the offer that you made and the contract that you signed, that you are able to meet all your obligations as well. Yeah. To go through the process and the timeline in total, I will put it on the screen and you can follow. You start, of course, with the search. That is important. On today, a lot of the premises, let's say almost 98%, of the properties that are listed, you can find on funda.nl. There are some other websites as well, like yav.nl or some others, also some selling agents that list it on their own website. But most of them you can all find on funda.nl. People also ask us regularly, do you also get some listings via relations that you have with other selling agents? Yes, we do. I have to say that on today, it's a really bullish market. So the selling agents want to send the information and the listings to a lot of people that they have a lot of viewers and also hope to have the highest price at that moment. So the most of times the viewings that are then off market, as they call it, and only sent by an email and not put online, it are not the best properties. So if you really want to have a good or the best property, just look on Funda, you will find a lot. But you need to be fast with booking a viewing. That is important. As I said before, after you did the viewing, we will do the property document review together with you. We will do the price research together with you. And then we help you to draft the offer and to submit it as well to the selling agent. As I said before, they will like that it comes from a colleague, a real estate broker as well, because it gives them some support that all the details and the elements that are important are checked before you make the offer. Then we have the experts that come into place. We just discussed about it within 1 week after approval of the offer. And then 1 week later, we have the signing of the purchase agreement. As I said, normally you have all information, all reports in your hand at that moment as well. Then we start with the mortgage application, of course, the moment that this purchase contract is signed. You send it to your bank or your mortgage expert together with the appraisal report, and then they can ask for the approval of the mortgage. And you have a cooling off period of 3 days after signing of the purchase contract. With some mortgage advisors, they seem to be able to respond to your mortgage application within 3 days. So then you know if your mortgage is approved within those 3 days. And yeah, you're totally secure. You don't need to cancel any contract. You can just go forward. We see that if you are just a client with a bank, sometimes it takes a little bit longer. I think it has to do something with the organization internally, and then it takes normally around, on average, 2 weeks to a maximum 4 weeks to have your mortgage approved. Yeah. If, of course, that applies and you have a financial clause in your purchase contract, then nothing is wrong, because that still means that if the financial condition applies and you cannot get a mortgage, you can still cancel the contract without paying any penalty. But then you needed to put that condition in your offer that you submitted before, of course. So you see 4 weeks to get the mortgage approved. And then after the mortgage is approved, then it's in a straight line to the notary. You receive a statement of completion from the notary. What is mentioned in there is the purchase price that you pay. It's the taxes and the costs that you need to pay, of course. Then deducted is the deposit that you may be paid in the meantime, and then the mortgage that will cover the most of the purchase price, and the balance will be then paid with your own savings. Yeah, but you will get a total overview from the notary, so you know exactly which amount needs to be in the account of the notary at the day of signing of the transfer deed. And then just before signing the transfer deed with the notary, you will do the final inspection of the house. You do that together with the seller or the selling agent, and we can be there as well. It's just to see that everything is still okay with the house, because when you did the viewing, it's already some weeks ago. In the meantime, the seller moved out as well, so there can always be something that happens to the property. Maybe there is a crack in the window, then you can put a deposit with the notary that everything will be solved and that you don't have extra damage to the property. But also to see that, for example, when the seller moved out, that you are sure that they moved out their furniture as well and they didn't leave everything, and you still have to take care of that. Yeah. And then you go to the notary, you sign the transfer deed over there, and you get the keys of the property after you sign the transfer deed. And then you're the legal owner, so you can use the house freely. Still one point that is important is the liability term. If there would be something wrong with the house and you were not able to discover before, and you can somewhere prove that the seller should have known before, then you can still put him liable for that. It's the best not to wait too long and to take action within 2 months, because most of the judges will say if you wait longer than that, then it will be difficult to prove that it's still the responsibility of the seller to solve the issue. So that's the process, that's the timeline, and that are the most important topics to take into account. I believe maybe there is are some questions in the chat.
We have one question that I have already answered, but maybe you would like to elaborate a little bit on that one. Marek asks, what are the technical aspects of property and what is the technical agent considering to include on their report?
Yeah, in the report, a lot will be covered over there, but there are different technical reports as well. The normal technical inspection will have a visual inspection of the house. Yeah? That means they are not going to break down walls and everything, but they are going to do the inspection on a visual level. What they also will do, for example, is something we see a lot, is that they will go to the bathroom and use like a meter to see if there is not too much humidity in the walls over there. Sometimes we see that it has to do with the joints between the tiles and that they need to be replaced. They will also see that if paintings need to be redone and all of those different things. So that's the visual inspection that the technical expertise will do. Next to that, you can also ask for a specific report where they look at asbestos as well. It's a material that was used in the past. And it can be interesting that you have a double check as well, for sure in older buildings, and for sure also when you want to do some renovations in it, if there is asbestos in the place as well. So that's the most of the checks they will do. They will check it from the roof until the crawl space, as I see over here in the basement, so that they will all check. But of course, if there is a wall, they will not open the wall to see if the pipes in there are still okay. So that's the difference between an inspection on all technical elements, or more like a visual inspection with maybe some extras like asbestos or something else.
Great. Thank you for your answer, Philip. We have another question from Marcela. This is a very good question. So we ask that a lot ourselves. We say perhaps a piece of advice. Is it recommended to buy right now? What does the market say?
Yeah. Yes, Marcela, that's a very good question. And it's also a little bit of a difficult question as well. What can we say is that we saw that this year the increase was very high in the market. That's clear. So we are in a bullish market. What we see, and that's what we discussed before, is there are different elements that are the reason why the market is going up. The most important, and it's like an economical law, it's offer and demand. That's the first one. And we see that there is still a lot of demand in the market from Dutch people, from expats in total, to say people looking for a place. And that gives that there is pressure in the market, both on the rental prices and on purchase prices. That will stay like that for some time. It will not be solved this year, not next year, and not in the coming years. So for sure, that will stay. The other elements that apply, and that maybe are the multiplier that effect of the shortage of supply, are interest rates or fiscal stimulus or the other elements that apply. And there can be a little bit of a change. As I said, mortgage rates tend to go up a little bit, but not that high until today. Also, some rules for the government, maybe on fiscal elements, that they will say, yeah, the interest rebate, we're going to reduce it a little bit, or some other elements that apply that will be a little bit less favorable for homeowners. But in general, let's say that we still believe that if the market will slow down next year, and then I use the word slow down, that we believe that prices will not go down, but only slow down. And then it's still interesting to buy. Of course, what you need to do for yourself as well is to see, do I buy on a short term or do I buy on a little bit of a longer term? We always say to people, if you buy for a period from 3 to 5 years, that's okay. If you're just looking for 1 year, I would not buy right now. And that's maybe better to rent something. But if you're looking at a longer term and you don't have the pressure to sell it at a certain moment and you can always wait, then you will always see on all graphs that throughout the years, if you take the time for keeping a house like 5 or 10 years, then the price always go up, and they go up faster than inflation as well. So it's always good then to make that investment.
Great. Thank you for the answer, Philip. Marcela, if you have any more questions, please just let us know. Another question from Marcia. Excuse me if I don't pronounce that correct. This is more related to the financing part. So is it possible to apply for a credit if I have been in the Netherlands for only 2 years and still don't have a permanent residence?
Yeah. If you're in the Netherlands for 2 years, then and for a credit, I believe that you mean for a mortgage. That is the question. Yeah, that should not be a problem. If you don't have a permanent residence, you will need to have a BSN number and some other elements that apply. But normally, there is always a solution. Of course, for your personal file, because I don't always know all the details of your personal file, we always advise you to talk to your bank, or even better, sometimes talk to a mortgage advisor, as they know exactly what are the main elements to apply for a mortgage. And it's also like that not all banks or not all financial institutions apply in total exact the same rules. So some parties that will say, we don't like to give too much mortgages at experts, it's too difficult for us. Other bank will say, yeah, but that's our target focus for clients. So in that specific case, I would say go to a mortgage advisor or a bank. But in general, I believe there should be no problem to get a mortgage.
Okay, thank you very much. Another mortgage related question from Samantha. What are the minimum requirements for a mortgage, and how much you recommend to save before searching for a house?
There are two questions in one. The minimum requirements for a mortgage, for sure you need to live in the Netherlands, you need to have a BSN number, as I just said, and you need to have some income, and there also need to be a certain guarantee on that income. Eh? If you have, for example, a contract of 1 year, then you will need to ask your employer for a letter of intent somewhere, as they call it, that they will prolong your contract, because of course the bank needs to be sure that you have an income to pay your mortgage back. There will be different other elements as well that will be taken into account, but that's something really for the bank or the mortgage advisor to consider. What is important is that the mortgage will always be depending on two elements to take into account. It's one, your salary that I just spoke about. And the second topic is the value of the property. The mortgage will only be like 100% of the value of the property. So that are the limits of your mortgage. And the lowest amount will apply, of course. How much savings do you need to have? Of course, you need to have the closing fees that apply. I spoke about it in the beginning of the presentation. You can also find them online. We have a calculator where you can calculate it. Normally, it's between 3 and 5%. 5% when you need to pay transfer taxes. 3% if you can be exempted. But it's around that amount. That's what you need for sure. So 5% of the purchase price. Let's take that as a rule of thumb. And of course, in today's market, we see a lot that the purchase price is higher than the value. So it's always good to have some thousands of euros as well. As extra savings to put a winning offer, but it depends really on the specific property, and that's of course the exercise we do with you together when we are looking at that specific place.
Okay, great. Thank you for the answers, Philip. Another question from Marek: what are the aspects or reasons of mortgage rejections? As I assume, I'll check the limits and possibilities of a mortgage even before placing an offer. So as I understand, Marek, you are checking the possibilities of your mortgage. Everything is positive. So what can happen on a later stage?
Normally, if you, I think as well, the question is, if you do that, when do you check for the mortgage? It's the first step you need to do that is important. Because if you need to make an offer or submit an offer and you don't know what is your budget yet, then you cannot make a winning offer because you cannot draft the ideal offer taking into account the price that you need to put on paper over there. Of course, the approval, the final approval will come in a later stage as we discussed. And it will depend on the purchase contract that you signed and also the report of the appraiser that you need to send to your bank to have that final approval. But the first step that you do is when you go to step into the market and do a search, first talk to your bank, first talk to your mortgage advisor, then they will tell you what is the mortgage that you can have based on your salary and all the elements of your specific file. And then the second thing, you come to us and we are going to look at the property. We are going to define the value of that property, and then we are going to see if that is possible, yes or no, to receive a mortgage on that is high enough to make the best offer.
Great. I don't see any more questions. In that case, guys, you're all, most of you are on the orientation phase, so I'm just going to paste the link in the chat. If you have any more questions or need more support in buying a home in the Netherlands, please feel free to book an intake with us. And then we can have a one-on-one chat with one of the agents and we'll see how we can support you.
Perfect. I thank you all to join our webinar. I hope it was interesting. And as Katie said, if you still have questions, feel free to reach out to you. And we like to help you, of course. Have a good day. Great. Bye-bye.
Thank you all. Bye.